the line. And every turn in the road brings you face to face with a new kind of terror. Mad Max.
Welcome back, everybody. It's now time for a retro Blu-ray review. We're taking a look at the original George Miller classic, Mad Max.
Ah, g'day, mate. I think I'll do the entire review in an Australian accent.
Because that won't get grating at all.
Yes. Okay, maybe not. So Fury Road has been on again, off again for quite some time. It is back on again. It got delayed because the place they were going to shoot it at got too green. It got like a record number of precipitation, and it, instead of looking like a desert, a post-apocalyptic wasteland, it's just too nice and vibrantly green. But it's back on track. Tom Hardy as, we think, Mad Max. The story is extremely secretive. And for me, the big news is Mel Gibson might actually have some involvement, because before, when it was originally shooting, his schedule didn't mesh. Now he apparently wants some kind of a cameo, or maybe to do an intro-outro voiceover similar to The Road Warrior. So that's going to be cool. We thought we'd go back and watch the original Mad Max to kind of brush up on the whole Mad Max lore. I think this movie's still the stunts, the road battles, still great by today's standards. Some of the stunts are just completely insane, and it's hard to believe that some stuntmen didn't die while doing this. Some of the stuff in between, though, you gotta keep in mind this movie was made on nothing. No budget, by brand new filmmakers with no experience. George Miller was a doctor before he made this movie. Mm-hmm. So you're going to get some scenes in this movie that are supposed to be very charged, very high drama. But what happens when you have situations like that and the actors are not very good dramatic actors?
Right.
Plus, some of the wardrobe doesn't really help the situation. I mean, when you've got a police chief who's got a big handlebar mustache, he's bald, he's wearing leather pants, he's bare-chested, and he has a black ascot, it's going to take a little bit of the edge off of the scene.
A little bit. Now, I can appreciate that when this movie came out, it was groundbreaking. People hadn't seen villains who dressed like this. We didn't have a hero who was so, you know, he was a tough guy who didn't say a lot. There was some crazy action stunts in the movie, and it really did inspire a wave of movies afterwards. Mm-hmm. There are bits and pieces that you see, like movies like Terminator, that kind of stuff. Even the Saw movies, there's a moment near the end that like clearly influenced a lot of movies from here on out.
And the leather-clad hero is such a standard thing, but I do believe, correct me if I'm wrong, this is the first time we had a completely head-to-toe leather-clad hero. This is before Terminator, The Crow, Snake Plissken, all that stuff.
So I've got to give props to George Miller for being a bit of a visionary here. Very cool production design. That being said, this movie is super boring. By today's standards...
I'm sure there's a lot of Max fans.
Yes, there probably are. But unbearably boring. Hardly anything happens. The action flies by in like 2.5 minutes. There is very little talking in the first half of the movie. It's a lot of sort of people staring down each other and stuff. Just dreadfully slowly paced. I'm sure that at the time it was like a bullet train of action, refreshing, low budget, cool filmmaking. Now it's Ambien and I hate it.
I can see how some people would think it feels like buying a bunch of really expensive fireworks. And then, you know, they just go off very quickly. And when they go off, it's pretty amazing. But then you're kind of left standing there going, well, now what?
Right.
But I do keep in mind how low the budget was. And, you know, we've both been there, done that.
Right.
And what they do accomplish, they accomplish extremely well. I think it's exceptional what they do. And for me, the cool parts, they carry me through the boring parts. Like that V8. The last of the V8s is such a legendary, iconic car. And Mel is, you know, even though some of the other actors aren't that good, Mel is so good in this movie.
Now, I definitely agree. I'll give you those points. But The Road Warrior is such a better movie that it begs the question, yeah, they had a low budget and they accomplished so much for the time. But now, when The Road Warrior still holds up, but this one is a snooze fest, why waste your 90 minutes watching this? You can just watch The Road Warrior twice.
Yeah, I can see that. And that's why I would say if you do watch the Max movies, if you've never been exposed to them, I think the order you should watch them is the Road Warrior first. And if you only watch one of the Max movies, it's a no-brainer. It's the Road Warrior.
Hands down.
And then if you really love the Road Warrior like I do, and you want something, some backstory, you want a prequel, then I don't think you're going to go too wrong with this. Even though Road Warrior does a great job of recapping everything in Mad Max in the first 2 minutes, this is, to me, a cool prequel. It's like, I love Aliens so much. I'm not a huge fan of the first one, Alien, but I'll watch it just because I love the second one so much. It's a cool setup.
Right. That brings us to best part.
Worst part.
Best part, Mad Max.
Oh, you have a best part. Wow.
Mad Max is only 93 minutes long. Worst part,
only
those 93 minutes feel like 5 hours.
You know, as much as I do like this movie, I'll agree that this could have been an hour. It could have been, they could have cut a half hour out of it, and I wouldn't have felt gypped at all, you know, that I paid full price for a 1 hour feature film. For me, the worst part is those lulls. There's this giant chunk in the middle of the movie where Max retires and he takes his family and he goes up north.
The happy music as they're on the road.
Yeah.
No.
And that really...
Let's get some ice cream.
It does drag on because she says, I'm just going to step out for a second on my own with the baby, even though these murdering crazies are chasing me. And she luckily doesn't get killed, but then it happens again. They get separated again and she doesn't get killed, and it just keeps happening. It gets to the point where when she finally buys it, I don't really feel that sorry for Max, because if it was me, it's like, stand behind me and don't move.
Right.
You know, wherever I go, you go. And for me, the best part is that gorgeous black Ford Falcon, last of the V8s. That thing just has such a presence to it. It's like the truck in Duel. It's like Jaws. It's just, you know, especially as cool as Max is when he gets behind that thing. Just the shots where it's driving on the road are just so amazing. You know, that blower going. And then when it's in action, even though it doesn't really get to do much, it's more of an intimidating force than an actual horsepower thing rolling over people. You know, Miller knew how to shoot cars back then, for sure.
Absolutely. So, if you are a big fan of the Max movies, I'm sorry that I trashed this movie. But hopefully, you can still enjoy The Road Warrior. Check that out. It's still great. But Mad Max, only if you're super bored or looking for a way to fall asleep.
All right, we'll be right back with The Right Direction.